my name is Madhavi Jadhav and I'm the founder of DatMet. So DatMet is a friend that helps teenagers and youth to go through their, you know, you can say, about 14 years and have a lot of things going in their lives, like you know, about the bodily changes, about safe unsafe touch, screen time, stress due to exams, relationships, etc., and the peer pressure, and they are actually unable to deal with them. Like them, there are 1.3 billion teenagers across the world who have no idea what is going on in their body as soon as they hit puberty. And 1/5 of them comes from India. WHO says that 50% of mental, behavioral and psychological problems have their occurrence during adolescence. Because many schools and colleges have no you know, sex education or mental health curriculum assigned for these teenagers. And even when we are talking to these teenagers, they have really, they're not comfortable. Like, you know, even parents are not comfortable talking about these topics. Neither the kids are comfortable talking with their parents. Imagine a kid who is 13 and wants to, you know, explore about his sexuality. He'll prefer a safe space, safe and private space, rather than, you know, asking his peers or parents. And that is what we are doing. We are providing a safe space for these teenagers to come and access the knowledge and then understand what are the problems that they are facing. So we have developed this app, which is also called as DatMet, and where we have content, very age appropriate content based on the workshops that we did. We worked with around 8,000 teenagers to understand what are the needs of the schools, what are the needs of the parents, what kind of, you know, content they are looking for, which the content is being developed by our you know, experts like psychologists and gynecologists. And then we have prepared a proper curriculum for students from, you know, 13 to 21 years old. And like, if we are targeting students of 7th standard, then the topic is more about puberty or, you know, friendship. While when we are talking about student of 12th standard, it is more about safe sex. So that's how we have, you know, worked on the curriculum as well. We personalize the content based on the usage of the user and also the location they are based. We use a lot of interactive comics because this is what, you know, really clicks with the students, where they can, if you have seen movies like Bandersnatch or played, you know, some games like Episodes, where you can choose the options as you go ahead. And at the back end, we build the profile of these teenagers. And we also have a chatbot platform to answer their queries as and when required. Till now, we have about 10,000 users and we have worked on a lot of comic books and, you know, resist so far, and we just now raised funding, and so we will be working on more of these content, making it more engaging and more relevant to these teenagers, coming up with more and more curriculum. We charge you know, parents or CSR foundations or even schools, if they are interested, about $10 per student per year. And currently, we are working with Central Academy, which works with in MP, Rajasthan, and UP. We have also got a project from state government of Jharkhand, where UNICEF is funding us. And there are a couple of more institutes in Pune, including Nikhil Karkare's school, Walnut. So these are our clients. So we just raised funding, as I said, by March we closed our round, and now we will be focusing more and more content and more going towards how we develop this curriculum and have simulated conversations and other behavioral experiments on the app. We have already partnered with UNICEF and we are looking forward to partner with MSDF and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation as well. Our aim is to reach out to 30 million users by, you know, next 5 years, and have gained some global traction as well. This is our team. I have around 9 years of experience working with Royal Dutch, working with, you know, Reliance, where I was leading the operations, and in Shambhaji, I was doing technical sales, and then Royal Dutch Shell, I was working on a $5 trillion project. Nishant comes with 13 years of tech background, where he has scaled products to hundreds and millions of users. Shruti comes with a unique insights from her Facebook and Lyft experience. And Asmita is our psychologist who has a degree of MPhil from Central Institute of Psychiatry, Ranchi. Here we are to take help from if there are product experts here and, you know, growth hackers who can help us to reach to more and more users. And of course, to network with school groups, partners to scale, like maybe Extra Edge if they are ready for that. And there could be some content sponsors who would like to be a part of some of the content, like financial literacy or on mental health, stress, or any sort of content that interests them. And of course, if we can get some accreditations from good universities. Thank you. I hope I finished it in 5 minutes. I'm not sure.
Thank you, Madhavi. Now we move to the founders of Walnut School. I think Madhavi referred to one of them. Nikhil, Arpita, and Ravindra, if anyone is presenting here, Amol can give the presentation rights.
Awesome. Okay, so hi, I'm Nikhil Karkare. I am the co-founder of Walnut School. It's very different from what is being presented here today as part of EdTech. We are kind of the end of EdTech, where EdTech is applied in the school. So we have three schools in Pune, one in Shivne, Fusringi, and one in Wakad. And we are a technologically ground up school. And I'm going to be speaking about a lot of things which schools deal with respect to technology. And we heard Vidya ma'am, we heard Bharat sir, and we heard Rishi sir speak about what the gaps are, especially in schools. And pretty much we've felt some of them and we've tried to solve them at various levels. And we've been successful, I would say, at least for the past year. And there are various challenges going ahead, and I'll be talking about them. So let's go ahead.
So the big long question is, what would it take to deliver the best curriculum to and
co-curricular education to students effectively, efficiently, and as Bharat sir said, at a reasonable cost in a school? So that is, I think, how we are in India. And we have to kind of innovate, do some kind of jugaad, get things together, and get things going. So what does it really take? At Walnut School, what we have is technology which we use from the ground up, as Vidya ma'am and Bharat sir rightly said. We didn't want to go through buying an ERP and then customizing it, because firstly, it would be very expensive. And secondly, it would take a whole lot of time. So we just started devising our own ERP from the ground up. So what we do is basically we have all the admin functions and the academic functions taken together. And we have perfect content, which goes hand in hand with technology, which is presented by the teachers to our students. And we also quickly integrate with third-party tools. Extra Edge is one of them. We have Tally. We have payment gateways. So we can quickly integrate our system with them, without going through the hassle of contacting third-party developers and falling at their feet, which becomes very painful for a school institution. So the strength here is having uniform academic delivery, right? What do we do at schools? We teach. And we have to do a very good job at teaching, whatever it is. It might be offline, or now it might be online. So we have to make sure that the value is seen by students as well as the parents. So we are dealing with 3 to 15-year-old children here. And parents are very involved with their child's lives at this, in this age range. So we have to target both the audiences, and we have to make sure that the academic delivery is very consistent and is very uniform. So we have a centralized content database, which we have made for student material and teacher materials. And we have an integrated platform delivery, which we use Google product suites for live classrooms. And we have our own e-learning suite too. So one more thing which we did was we developed our own e-learning suite, because getting a standard e-learning package and then customizing it to a school environment, which is very different from an individual, becomes kind of a challenging task. So we have designed our own e-learning package which is a product by itself with, I'll be speaking about it later, for school environments specifically. We again have a product lifecycle management where each of our products, whichever is being taught in the classroom, which is being sent home to every student, is tracked right from creation up to sending home. And this content is basically what differentiates Walnut School from, I think, many of the other schools, is because we have, you know, put in a lot of effort. We have an R&D team which develops this content. And this content is where, you know, the simplicity comes in, the ease of use comes in, the pedagogy comes in, and easy understanding comes in, and of course, the outcomes come in. So what binds everything together is the curriculum map, which we develop, is basically where we plan every period for every class, for every subject, for the whole year, right before school starts. So this, you know, today is when our curriculum map gets finalized for the 1st of June. So, you know, we know exactly what is going to be done when, and we can see variances if any occur at real time. And then we can talk to teachers and figure out what exactly went wrong. Did the students find it difficult? Or did the teacher go too slow? Did she divert from what was supposed to be taught? And a whole load of other things. The curriculum map also helps us communicate very easily with the parents, because, you know, we track what the teacher has taught every day. And that way, teachers are also up to date with what their teaching plan is, as well as the parents. You know, parents get an update immediately once the teacher updates their curriculum map. And that helps bring in transparency,
saying, you know, this is exactly what we do in the school, and this is what we taught, so that the parents can also discuss these things with the child, and if necessary, go over some things which they did in the day or the week.
So e-learning is specially designed for CBSE schools. We have thousands of hours of videos, lakhs of questions, and this carries weight in the final report. So again, we have integrated it with our school management system, where there is some weightage in the result, where the students get serious in answering these class tests and quizzes. So they have been specifically designed for school environments itself, where we know there can be copying happening. We have some proctored examinations too. And, you know, that kind of
brings in a lot of seriousness to the e-learning. The videos obviously have to be watched at home. There's no video watching happening in the school environment. Of course, then comes the online classrooms and lectures. So we have integrated GC, Google Suite, from the initial day, the first day of school. And that has helped us transition easily to the online medium. So we saw a lot of schools struggle. We, in fact, helped a lot of schools get on board with how to get on board with online. And for us, it was a 48-hour job, you know, where our teachers were anyway using our learning system in the class. And all they had to do now was to figure out how do you present
live on an online classroom. Now, as Vidya ma'am said,
they did have their reservations about how am I going to look on camera, how am I going to speak. You know, there's nobody in front of me, and we had to deal with those effort issues too. But I think overall, we took around 2 weeks to get to the point where we could say that the teachers were very comfortable talking to the camera and looking at images of students in front of them. We also have a lot of personalization which we do. And, you know, so our teachers keep calling them on a one-on-one basis, calling students on a one-on-one basis to find out what their progress is. If they have not been attending class, we usually call them and find out what's happening. Because these are trying times. And we understand that, you know, a lot of things are happening at home. And we want to make sure that our students are on the same page as we are and are interested to learn. And we want to understand their problems, and we want to try and solve them too. So we have, as I said, we have third-party integrations which help reduce our load of doing double work, which help increase efficiency tremendously, and also keep our focus. You know, our focus is to run the school. So I'm specifically talking about the second point of nuances of an education institution. And running a school will basically have a million parts. But if each part starts running on its own, it becomes very difficult to keep track there's duplicity which happens. We've dealt with Excel mania, you know, where we have multiple file names and the stuff like that. You know, every educational institution faces it. In fact, as Bharat said, most of the schools or colleges in India don't know today what is their fee paid status, or what is the outcome, what is the balance that is remaining from parents who have not paid fees yet. And, you know, these are things which we wanted to get rid of at a very basic and a ground level. So we, you know, just simply integrate with third party software, which makes our lives much easier. I think I'm on time, right? I have a few minutes. Sudhanva?
Yes, couple of minutes.
Okay. All right, thanks. So the school management system is where, you know, we get all these administrative functions, reports. We have to give a ton of reports to a ton of regulatory authorities. And it's actually, it becomes a joke and it's fun. You know, it's so many people to report to and so many reports to give, that if we would have to dedicate a few people just for creating these reports every day. And that would not be financially feasible. So what our school management system does is basically creates templates and make sure that each report is, you know, generated in a couple of seconds. These reports also help us with centralized communications. I mean, different reports, but these centralized communication helps in maintaining a uniform message that goes out from the school. So what we have observed is a lot of people say a lot of things in the school, which causes a whole load of miscommunication. So having a central platform where we can use it for communication creates a very big plus point for us and for our parents, because they know exactly what we are trying to say. And if they have questions, they know exactly where to look for and whom to ask. So I think that creates a whole load of transparency and ease of use for our parents, because many times the children are too young to get into all these details. So one good thing about schools is every year the same tasks, most of the tasks repeat again and again. So we identified this, and you know, many times what happens is there's always something new which is happening, which takes away the regular time, regular tasks which are to be done. So we developed a task management system, which was very simple. We looked at a whole ton of them again. You know, we looked at Slack, we looked at whatnot, but it didn't really suit our requirements because of the repeatability of what we had and the specific team groups which we needed. We couldn't get something which could be customized for us. So we just developed our own task management system, which, you know, basically make it very easy for us to track and set KPIs for our admin staff as well as our teaching staff for whatever academic admin functions that they have to do. And we actually track employee performance based on the TMS. So that brings in, you know, a lot of transparency again in within the organization too. So as I said, you know, school typically has a lot of independent moving parts, and which makes syncing really hard. So a single platform which provides this space where the teachers, administrators, students, and parents can come together and create a virtuous cycle and not a vicious one is what we are trying to do at Pawnee. It basically decreases load on the teaching and the non-teaching staff and increases efficiency. So technology has been a boon to us because of the first point. It obviously reduces our headcount. As I said, you know, we would require a whole load of team put together just for generating reports and even to analyze accounts and do separate entries in Tally, which just is not feasible. It makes management come to know what is happening at a dashboard level, which basically eases, you know, their questioning and their insight and look at how patterns are developing. Also, it brings a uniform experience for parents, which I've been harping about for the past few minutes. So, you know, to conclude, basically, we have a scalable learning system. We have an upgradable learning system. So we are kind of resilient to what new things are going to come ahead in the future because we just plug it in. And we maintain quality. So, you know, we are kind of reliable with things where they always work, so to say. And we this gives our school an edge because, you know, we have seen a whole load of pandemonium in the pandemic where parents have been complaining left, right, and center about getting mixed messages from the school, from the teachers, connections being dropped off and whatnot. And one thing which has made us stand apart is basically that, you know, none of the parents, none of Walnut's parents have this kind of complaint. So, you know, so basically we have happy students and happy parents as a result. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikhil. Let's move on to Proctor, your pocket classroom, and that's the startup. Nishant Agarwal.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon. Okay, perfect. Good afternoon, all of you. First, let me thank MCCIA for giving this opportunity. And it was very good session, a lot of learnings from previous speakers. So I represent Proctor. I am founder of Proctor.com. We are a 4.5 years old edtech company. We started in Delhi, but I moved to Pune in year 2017. And I think I took a right decision moving to a education hub plus a technology hub. And we are getting very good people here to work with us. So we have been doing well. So just a second. So we are a B2B edtech company. We are a B2B edtech company wherein we provide solution for educational institution. So our product basically comprises of a management solution wherein these institution can manage their day-to-day operations like fees, attendance, exam, etc. At the same time, they can manage basically sharing videos with the students. They can conduct online tests using our platform. They can conduct live lectures using our platform. So we provide an end-to-end solution. As Rishi sir said, basically there are different journeys of a student. So we cover from right from admission until they leave the institution. So we cover each and every aspect of that journey, right? And we provide an online assessment solution. There is school management, ERP as well we are providing. So it's all part of a single product we have been providing. It's very extensive. What we identified is just providing this solution may not be enough for these teachers and students to stick to our platform, because on daily basis, they need to interact with various platforms or various other services they need to avail, right? So we are shifting our model from just providing these software solutions to these institutions to a more of marketplace model, wherein, we try to solve these problems. So on one side, we have service providers, be it coaching institutions, be it schools, be it colleges, be it basically non-educational providers, like maybe somebody selling mobile phones to the students, or maybe there are coding classes, dance classes, etc. There are a lot of providers. So this industry is very fragmented. It's very unorganized. There is no standardization, right? And due to basically boom in this edtech segment, there are a lot of players in this market. So acquiring a particular student or a learner, the cost has become much higher now because competition has increased, right? So we try to reduce these problems. And on the student side, they need to, as I already mentioned, they need to interact with various platforms. For example, if they have to take a dance class, they need to go to some other platform. They need to take coding class, they need to go to other platform. Then for coaching, they need to use some different mobile application. For school classes, they need to use some different platform. So we try to unify that by giving a single mobile application. And then if we go to tier 3 or 4 or maybe lower city regions, so many of the services are not available, which will be available using a platform, right? And many other non-educational services are not met in many cities yet. So we try to cater to these problems using Proctor solution, wherein I would like to divide it in two parts, basically what we have been doing till date. So we have done digitization of the institution, wherein their operational and educational part has been digitized. Now we are moving ahead with providing a value-added services on both ends, both at the institution side and to the students as well. So if we visualize it, there will be a single mobile application for students. We call it a super app, wherein they can access the content which is provided by their institution they are studying at. In addition, they will get all value-added services from the same app, right? And it will comprise of not only educational services they require, but non-educational services as well. For example, if they have to buy a mobile phone, they will be able to do that using our mobile app only, right? In addition to this, we will incentivize the institution as well. if that student is belonging to that particular institution, we will incentivize them also to make some additional money using that, right? So this is our business plan. And then we try to cover complete journey of the students, because we cater to preschools, we cater to schools, coaching classes, we cater to colleges as well. So once students joins Proctor platform, he can basically maintain his whole life journey using our app itself. So it will be kind of search engine for students. They can find any kind of service using the mobile app, just like Google. And then they can avail any of the services on that platform, which are available. So we have been in talks with many vendors for tying up with them so that we can provide their services on our mobile apps. So Samsung, Front Row, these are some of the providers we have already tied up with. And some other solutions are there, which we are in talks with. This is a journey till date. So we incorporated in year 2016, November. Then we moved to Pune next year. And we have launched basically various modules like online assessments, live classes, e-learning, LMS. So things have been going great. We partnered with almost 535 plus institutions in just last quarter, which comprises of schools and coaching classes primarily. So this is the traction we have gained till date. There are over 1 million students who are on our platform. We cater to almost 125 plus cities. Since we are selling online, so we have a very widespread. It's not concentrated in one city. Almost 12,000 plus teachers are there who are accessing our platform, or they are teaching to students using our platforms, which are part of 2,500 plus institution. And these are some of the premium institutions we have onboarded. Right. So these are the segments we cater to. In informal segment or coaching institute segment, we cater to K-12 segment, competitive exams, and then non-educational as well, like dance classes, karate classes, etc. And in the formal segment, we cater to preschool, schools, colleges, and professional colleges. We are not very strong at, but still we are building for them. We already have few clients in that segment as well. This is the market size we have been catering to. It was expected to be $2 billion in year 2022, but due to COVID, that has gone double now. So we are expecting it to reach to $3.5 to $4 billion in 2022, right? So it has been growing at a much faster pace now. These are some of the competing companies to us, both in coaching segment and school segment. We could not find a single product which could cater to both the segments. So we have different competition in different segments. And the business model we have been working upon is very unique to us. We don't see any competition in that. This is a revenue model we have been targeting. So ancillary services which we are providing right now, we are charging a minimal amount. So we solve that pricing problem as well. We have ensured that our system is very easy to use, considering the non-tech nature of our customer segments. So we have made it very easy to use. And then we plan to have major chunk of revenue from the value-added services we are going to provide to students now, which will be commission on the sales, which will be done through our platform. We will promote various services. We will generate leads for the partner institutions as well. So that will again be a business model for us. So I'm the founder and CEO of Proctor. I have over 16 years of experience working in product-based tech companies. My previous experience includes basically majorly working with the large financial institutions like Fidelity Investments and Citibank in Japan. Then after that, I did MBA, and then I started my first venture with the name LegalLink.jp, that is providing legal services in Japanese SME market that is doing well. And then I started Proctor. Once I identified this challenge in this particular industry, then I'm joined with Charchit Agarwal, who looks after sales and marketing efforts. He's also MBA from Pune only, and he looks after complete sales at Proctor. Then we are being advised by a very strong board of business people coming from various backgrounds. So we have this very strong advisory board. So they help us on a regular basis. That's it from my side. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nishant. Now we move to PEP study education. Indivar Verma, Saket Kumar, and Runit Roshan. So if one of them would like to make a presentation.
Thank you so much. Hi, everybody. It was fantastic knowing everyone and their efforts coming into EdTech sector. So we are basically three idiots. So what we three do is we try to change the assessment, school assessments with some difference and bringing some lot of common sense. So I never understood why, when I worked for 15 years in various companies, and I never understood why we wear blazers. You know, it's a hot climate and why still we wear blazers? So it doesn't make any sense. So similarly, there are a lot of aspects which technology can replace, bring sense into the schooling. So we did this very consciously. We thought of Saket, is from IIT Bombay, I'm from XLRI, and Runit is from IIT Kharagpur. So we wanted to solve a couple of problems which are in the K-12 segment, especially the student-teacher ratio. And then we see that it's very difficult for a teacher to take care of the syllabus and the co-curricular activities, everything. And there are continuous assessments, continuous, you know, churning of academics. But what it is leading to? So why, when you take so many tests, weekly tests, so when you ask a school, they will say it's for the, to know the knowledge of the student. And when you go to the parents, they say, hey, the school conducts so many assessments, we don't understand why. But why do we conduct assessments is to give the knowledge to the student that, hey, these are your gaps and you need to move further. And for a teacher to analyze how her teaching is, you know, observed by the students, how much of the knowledge or any of the key abilities is getting into students. Now, that is one challenge. These, a part of these two, in our Indian system, we have, you know, the public examination only at 10th standard. Until then, the students are evaluated only by their own teachers who taught them the lessons and who taught, you know, who prepared the question papers. So they may be excelling due to some bias or due to some, you know, pure flow of marks. But that's what we need to replace. Why don't we have a large-scale exam at every quarter for every classroom? And this can help give, reduce the number of assessments and increase the efficiency of an assessment. So what we think is assessment should help students identify their academic gaps and enable them to progress rather than just conducting repeatedly. So with this idea, we started our service called PEP Test. So PEP Test is for K-12, that is currently we are serving class 6 to 12, and the content is proprietary and we have hot taxonomy backing it up. So these are the couple of things which we are doing. And it's minimum 3 tests to maximum 6, it depends on the school, and our users cover all the stakeholders of a, you know, school, basically the student, teacher, principals, everyone. So we have, yeah, we are online, we are offline, and it is completely backed by AI technology. So if suppose your child is giving one test, we will be able to very easily say which chapter and in the chapter, which topics he's good at and he's not good at. Along with that, we also try to tell in each subject what is their knowledge, understanding, or critical thinking skills. So this can really help the child himself to progress with the adaptive learning methods we provide. And for a teacher, it is like, yeah, we are first of all saving a lot of time for them by, you know, taking out the question papers, preparation, evaluation, because everything we take care of. And providing a classroom analysis, how out of the so many chapters she taught, how many chapters were relevant to the student, how many they understood really. So these metrics can help the principal take a data-oriented decision, guide teachers accurately. It's, we all are humans and we are tend to have bias. We love good students, and you know, personally, I think all of you would agree that in your class, the you know, good behavior students were always being half mark or one mark is going more to them. And from there, even the teachers who are talking very much, who are talkative, who are, have good presentation skills, are very good, well recognized by the principals. But to avoid all this, you need to really go to the data and check, are they effective in their classroom or not? So this is what PEP Study does, and we have been really helping out lot of institutions, and we are saving 80% of the time and efforts of a school on assessments. Now, yeah, large-scale assessments we have. We also have, hard stacks on me, which is recommended by the CBSE. We provide learning analytics up to topic level and adaptive learning for children to practice on our mobile app, web browser, anywhere. So these are a couple of, accolades we got. And these are some testimonials from the, principals who worked with us in 2019 when we launched the, product, the prototype of it. This is a scale we have grown. This is a traction. Though we have started in 2018, we registered that study. We kept 1 year for research, launched ourselves in July 2019. By September, we implemented our first implementation with zero errors with 2,000 students. And these were offline, that is hard copy ones, and then converted to online for results. So we work typically with the rural schools because that's the ambition we three had, Saket, Runit, and me. The idea was to, we struggle for our education. We are absolutely the three idiots team. So from there, we evolved. So we thought, yeah, first, let us, if our apps can be used in a rural background of India, then we are successful everywhere. So that's the projection we took. We got official membership of, as a official EdStaff member from Amazon. We won an international award in November 2019 in BML Propel event among 5 countries as best technology services company. In Feb 2020, we completed our first year, and that's where we were confident about the product. Yes, COVID has kissed everyone in March last year, but we went on. We had incubated at Riddle, that's a KJ Somaya institution backed up. And then Jan 2021, we are seed funded. So currently from 2000 in the first year, we are already 10,000 plus students we have, and students, teachers, and principals using our tool. And yeah, this is what we provide through meaningful assessments, because we are trying to bring some sense into assessments, and we are trying to build a profile for students so that they know what, where they are lacking and where they should study, rather than studying the whole syllabus again. Teachers would know where their students are lagging specifically and can give personalized homework. This is what that study does. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Now we move to Extra Edge, Sushil Mundra and Abhishek Ballab.
So good afternoon, everyone. I think privileged to be part of this panel. I was very intently making notes and listening to all the speakers. So without further delay, because we are already running late, let me share my screen and start. So my
Please
name is
make it full screen.
Yeah. So my name is Abhishek Ballab. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Extra Edge. And this is what we do in a single line. We help admission teams win for education brands. But prior to that, on a very 30,000 feet level, what we do, so we are enabling 250,000 education institutes all across the world acquire the next 30 million students via power of marketing automation and predictive analytics. So think of us like a sales operating system, but built for, a vertically education industry. And we operate like a B2B SaaS company. One of the reasons or one of the things that I have learned being a education entrepreneur for near about now 4.5 years is that it's very, very important to be really good at one thing. And education software and how education institutes buy software has been commoditized over a period of 40 years now, 40 to 50 years. So you need to really be seen uniquely in front of the buyer who's an education owner or any kind of person who's purchasing the software. So being good at one thing and differentiating yourself in their eyes, however simple it may sound, I think that's existential for your survival and growth. So we focus only on one thing. We are not an ERP. We are not a CRM. We only focus on one thing. How can we increase your admissions? And we are building deep expertise and technology stack only for that. So just wanted to emphasize on that. Being a number, so one of the fastest growing SaaS companies because of what we have done so far. We have around 170 odd customers. We have growing at near about 150% year on year in terms of annual growth. We are close to $1 million in ARR, so precisely around 5 crore we are getting there. We have raised near about 14 crore of venture capital, so we are like we are properly a VC backed company and have to grow with that. We are 55 people, been in the industry for around 4.5 years, and born and brought up and grown in Pune, so we are a Puneri based SaaS company and proud to be one, right? So that's just to give you a sense of it, that where are we in terms of our numbers upfront. Now moving to it, these are the people who have supported us in our journey. So Sprout, Pentathlon, 9 Unicorns, Indian Angel Network, Thai, First Check. We have been very blessed to be part of Thai Nurture, and people like Vishwasar and other people who are there have been very supportive in our early journey when we started, and we are really grateful for that. And also we never forget that, because as you grow, you should always remember who you helped when you're starting up. So very important. So these are the, some of the investors who have kept on helping us over our journey. Predominantly, what I wanted to share with you is that today admission teams across education brands from university to a study abroad understand that they will only win, or they will be able to enroll more, when they understand student journey. So understanding the prospect or the buyer journey is one of the most important winning strategies that a brand can have. What kind of kids come to your brand? What is their demographic? What is their persona? What are the leading and lagging indicators when somebody takes admission or does not take admission? And how you can press those buttons based on those leading and lagging indicators is what we enable for these brands today. Now, COVID-19 has hit India and across the world with a kind of grinding halt. And education institutes predominantly, which were offline in operations because of their nature, right? And even the institutes and private tutoring, they came to a grinding halt. Now, this was the problem or the challenge that everybody was facing last year, right? So what was a second order effect? So whenever we face an existential crisis in our life, there is some first order effect and second order effect. The first order effect was panic. The decision was not being, they were not able to decide what to do next. They were in a state of I would not say ignorance. They were looking for information that what should we do next, because everybody was on the same boat. And slowly now, from that state of perplexness, people are moving to a state of readiness, right? And from a state of readiness, this is what we have observed. So COVID was a demonetization moment for education, what fintech probably was there at the last. And what has happened is that, as very clearly Rishi articulated, that acquisition technology has adopted very, very fast, and other technologies too. But the technology has adopted by around 10 to 15 years now. Today, the buyers are ready. They are asking right questions. Last year, they were scared. They did not know what to do, right? So that's the change that we have witnessed, and we have seen like an admission player in this industry. Now, more to it, what has happened with sales or admission, as we say, for education institutes? Very interesting trend. Last year to this year, the online search volume has increased in education by around 3x, which probably means that from a supply side, every student sitting in a tier 3, 4, 5 colleges is searching for a course and curriculum and trying to reach out to a brand digitally. So Google, Facebook, Instagram becomes now very consequential. What it was to a retail or to a probably e-commerce today is same for education. Now, entrance examinations got delayed but got completed later on. There was a new education policy that supports skilling and distance education, leading to a lot of universities opening their distance education there. And everybody started, or every university and group of institutes, there are around 1,000 odd universities in India and around near about 50,000 group of institutes. They all wanted to have an edtech component to their business, as Dr. Vidya very clearly said, which meant that they could acquire more students. And admission teams started to work remotely, and they were given more preferences because these are the ground workers who are responsible for driving acquisition leads, and they're responsible for top line and bottom line of an education's business or an institute's business. So these were some of the supply side and demand side signals what we saw. And only education was not seeing the signals. And what this indicated to Extra Edge, because we were working with so many brands, that there is a new way that buyer and seller, and in this case, the buyers are predominantly Gen Z students and parents, and the sellers are predominantly education brands, right? So there was a new way they were interacting with each other. And that's what I thought I'll talk about, that there's a behavioral shift, that how in every industry, buyer and seller are meeting and interacting with each other. Just to give you a perspective of what I'm talking about is that, look at the old way and new way. right from broking, rental, ATM, hosiery, auto and rick, vegetable market, right? We were all consumers on the top of the funnel here. Now we are no longer those consumers. We are consumers to the new way today. I have not gone to ATM for the past 2 years. I still have around 6 ATM cards on my wallet, right? Now that's a fundamental change and shift, because the digitization and changing buyer behavior and demographic shift is enabling these kinds of behaviors today, right? Most of you are consumers in this change and buyer and seller dynamic. And that's what's happening in education. So admission is changing for good. And what's changing in admission, ladies and gentlemen, is that the best institutes and brands are reinventing in two core areas. One, how they skill students. That's the learning and pedagogy, which Dr. Vidya spoke about. But also on the other hand, on the left-hand side, how they acquire students digitally today. And that's where Extrage is solving that problem for them, right? So what are the signals? Three core signals. First of all, more spend is happening on online. So print PR, conventional spend is more moving towards online. People like, you know, Nikhil, who's also a customer at Walnut, they know that very, very clearly, right? So also, you know, people are having their dedicated admission and counseling team. So there's a new marketer emerging and who are occupying seats on these education brands who are making these calls, how to do marketing digitally, how to have a good system of records from and where we come in. And also, you know, while we are seeing this trend, we are also seeing lot of, supply side signals. So India's gross enrollment ratio, if few of you are in education, you know what that means, that how many people are eligible for higher education and education. Because of the movement and Skill India of government's initiative, it will become near about 30% by 2022, which means new 5 to 8 million new kids will come and they will get acquired by a school to buy probably an upgrade across their academic journey. And every point in time during an academic cycle, money will be spent to acquire them, to educate them. And that's where Extrage comes in to help that optimize that cost. Now, how expectation of students are changing? Again, we have a bird's eye view. I know we probably churn more than 50 lakh odd leads every year, more than near about, I know, a lakh odd admissions happen on Extrage platform every year, right? Why that? So we have a very clear view of what's happening. Right. So students and teams understand that students and parents want a new age experience, a new admission experience. It needs to be real time. There needs to be social engagement. It needs to be right communication at the right time. And they need to counsel and guide. So counseling and guiding, or what we call assisted sales. So today people don't get sold, they buy. And that's what's happening with kids today. And that's what's happening with parents today. I'm very, very sure, you know, Vishwas sir's, you know, kids, you know, he might not be telling what to do, what they want to do. They must be telling him that this is what we want to follow. And he should be enabling that thought process to it. And that's happening through all the middle class today in India, where the kids who are the Gen Z and Gen Y are making their own trends, making their own decisions, and parents are supporting them, which was not the case with my parents. So there is a change in the buyer for the first time in Indian education system, right? And that's what we are seeing. And this is what is changing education marketing forever. And that's what I would like to focus on, that marketing is now where students are. You know, it's not on a hoarding on FC Road. Probably it's probably on Instagram, right? Admissions is more counseling. It's not selling. Brand is more online, mobile, social. Positioning is more periodic and consistent. For example, if admission is starting on April, I will just do promotion in the month of January and I'll be okay. No, you can't do that. Gillette sells his razor all across the year. We still know Mark 3. It's more branding there. So you need to be ubiquitous across the year. And counseling and having an internal team members who work like the torch bearer of your brand, like a salespeople, is very, very critical and important. So pitching becomes very, very important. And this changes education marketing for good. And the way admissions happen, we'll need a strategy change. People are adopting it. It's more discovery, it's more tools, and it's more engagement. And that's why we build Extrage. And that's where we are building Extrage. And I wanted to, you know, not share with you what Extrage is doing. Probably most of you would not be interested in what we are doing, but just to tell you that what is happening in our industry today in admissions, and then triage back to what Extrage is doing, because I think that is more meaningful. And if you look at it, that the first aspect is an admission platform, which is basically understanding the student journey in very simple. Now you need to have the system of records to understand that. The second is marketing, which is basically engagement. Once you have understood where the student is in the journey of the admission, you need to utilize the right signals in the form of communication, outreach, right from all forms known to email, SMS, normal to video, audio, AI, bot, and so on and so forth. You need to press that engagement. and you all have been doing, any brand has been doing sales for the past 10 years to use classification and a bit of machine learning to understand your buyer clearly. Now, this has already happened in retail. It has already happened in probably e-commerce, where people use machine learning, intelligence for sales based on the prior data. We are bringing that to education also today, right? So this is what, you know, three things what we are doing. We have seen great success. We have brought counseling teams online, first generation counseling teams online in the age group of 40 to 55. We have brought online applications and increased that for brands in India and abroad. We have transformed entire offline admissions to online for some of the very big brands in India. And we have used a bit of intelligence and conversational marketing tools for brands to take everything on WhatsApp or take everything on that. So we have been helping these brands to completely move and embrace digitization in terms of their outreach, marketing, and sales. Some of the success stories, like, you know, in case of Bharti Vidyapeeth, we literally increased their admission and application.
Now we are
5x. Yeah, I'm just done. And that's what wanted to share, that we are building the new age admission tools and stack, and which allows you to leverage the student intelligence and take smart admission or decisions for your organizations. So this is my last slide. This is what we are trying to build, that how can we make admissions predictable, data-driven for brands across the globe. And this will give the ultimate competitive advantage to any brand, because prediction of sales and understanding of student journey or admission customer journey is the competitive advantage that every business seeks around the world, and so will the education institutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhishek. Now the last presentation for today, the founders of Words Maya EduTech, Harshad Bhagwat and Sandeep Pode.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's not easy to be the last person, but I'll make sure I finish this in just 5 minutes. So thanks, Vishwas. Thanks, MCCI, for providing yet another platform. Great to present in front of Vidya ma'am, Bharat sir, and Rishi sir, our updates. Actually, they have been seeing us for many years now. So what Words Maya does is what AI cannot overtake, right? So in the age of robots, soft skills will reign supreme, is what LinkedIn report says. And when these same recruiters go to colleges, they find that students are not able to even communicate well and show any soft skills for that matter. Most of our engineers cannot even speak English. So this is the problem of unemployability as what we are solving. So we improve confidence and impact in specific communication and other soft skills of students and early age professionals. We work with colleges and as well as corporates to improve their placements and brand image, improve efficiency. We are seed funded by IIM Calcutta and Will Grow, which is one of the largest social impact investor. And we have won many awards, one which is we are very proud of from the Department of Science Technology. They awarded us top 50 startups to transform India. Rishi sir mentioned we have been building this patiently for last 5 years now. Harsh, myself and Sandeep come from corporate experience and moved to education out of passion. We both have innovation and product development experience working in corporates, and now building this step by step. So far, we have empowered 12,000 paid students across 50 institutes, and the completion rate is very high because of the model which is in my next slide. And we take assessments. Most of our students improve by one grade in our assessments. The core experience of learning, we have made it so fun that students like our experience and they give us high rating, which is very, very important to keep them motivated even online. The way we do things is a blended approach. Well before pandemic, we have always been following that we teach people, we teach theory part of communication on Words Maya app, and we take their practice sessions online with our expert trainers or on site in large colleges and corporates. And we have the assessments rubrics for pre and post course assessment. And we have internal LMS to continuously track these students and the learning and give dashboard to all the stakeholders. So some of our courses actually start with sometimes basic English grammar when we deal with BCom, BBA colleges, or communication presentation for engineering colleges, interview preparation, LinkedIn resume for MBA colleges, and even email communication, team meetings, client communication when we deal with corporates. In February itself, we got approved by AICT under their NEET scheme, and our courses, these English speaking communication soft skills and interview preparation, are now AICT approved, and they are on their website. And now, because of pandemic, we are seeing a very high adoption across India. These are some of the brands we have worked with: Western Maharashtra, all state universities, MIT, Indira, Vishwakarma. And now we are seeing more and more adoption outside Maharashtra as well because of this online learning trend. In pandemic, actually, we have worked more with corporates. We have worked with engineers in Kohler John Deere. We have worked with project managers in Praj, as well as software engineers in Centelon. And we have been approved in the CSR programs of Bajaj and Atmaja Foundation, which is funded by eClerks. And now what's next, right? Something great is cooking inside Words Maya. We now know what students in colleges, what colleges are struggling with. We know what companies look for. We are coming up with job-oriented specialization programs with our specific knowledge. So a student in college, we were taking that student to job-ready with soft skills and interview preparation. Now we are partnering with job partners and giving very, very specific skills so that we can take the student from college to corporate ourselves. So we are working on pilot in a couple of institutes and few students, and we are launching very soon this next Words Maya. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Over to you, Vishwas, sir.
Well, first of all, over 160 people staying on for one extra hour is something that one would have never expected in an online meeting paradigm these days. But, it bears testimony to the strong content and the participants that have really been on this program. So I want to thank each one of you. Thank you very much. Thanks for all the speakers, Bharat, Vidya, Rishi, and of course, all our our startups who have been able to present a wide variety of technologies and stuff they have been doing. And of course, we only had the opportunity of showcasing a few, and there are a lot more. But I hope that this event has brought together, and I'm hoping that everybody has found something that they should take back and connect post this program. And I'm sure people have been taking notes on that. And I hope if there's anything that you would like MCCIA to help with connecting the dots here, please reach out to us. Neeraj and Sudhanva are here. Reach out to the same email ID that you got, and we will be happy to make those connections. Again, before you log off, the next third Friday of next month, which is June, we will be doing Industry 4.0, the IoT in manufacturing. We will be showcasing startups, and maybe we'll have a different group of people interested in it. But please do show up and be a part of this initiative at MCCI. Thank you very much again for being a part of this. Look forward to having all of you again in future events. Thank you so much.